See, friends, we have been trained in our institutions that homeopathy, the pivotal, the axiom, the center of homeopathy is similia, similibus, curantum. Very simple, very easy to understand, easily comprehensible law indeed. It is nothing but an attempt to bring into order health. So what to do? We have been trained that to bring this disorder into order, we have to create a natural disease picture collected from the patient, and we have to simply apply the artificial disease picture that is coming from the drug proving. Very simple. But actually what happens, we have been trained that for a better prescription, we have to upgrade our knowledge on Organon of Medicine, repertory, Metra Medica, which is very important for a final prescription, going very well. But the problem comes, once you complete your first year, second year, and when you advance to your third,
Raja?
Sir is having some network issue, I think, sir.
Yeah. You have to contact him on...
Yeah, yes.
Hello? Yeah, am I audible, sir, now?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, it is raining here a little bit. Maybe the problem is with the internet.
Yes, sir. So you can off your video, sir. And you can share.
Yeah, sharing once again. Okay. Yeah, somebody please tell me, is it okay?
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Fine. Yeah, we started from here. A classical homeopathic prescription depends upon three subjects: Organon of Medicine, repertory, and Metra Medica. We call it as triad of prescription. Goes very well. The problem starts to the students when it comes to therapeutics. We have surgery therapeutics, medicine therapeutics, surgery. They'll ask you, name some remedies for fissure, name some remedies for nasal polyp. So the total picture changes over here. So far we have been taught that homeopathy is nothing but similia, similibus, curantum. But the problem starts here, the confusion starts here. And we have been taught in our subjects that the remedies has to be well proven, constitutionally proven, both mental, physical modalities. Until unless the remedy is well proven, you cannot bring them into homeopathic prescriptions. But contrary to that, we have some remedies like Acalypha indica, Syzygium jumbolinum, Rowelphia serpentina, Justicia the toda, so on and so forth. These remedies are not a classical remedy. Okay. They are nothing but not a so well proven remedies in Metra Medica. Then we have why they are, what they are doing in our Metra Medica. This is a great question arises. And another problem rises in our minds when we read literature, different types of literature. Like one side will say constitutional prescription, another side will have a literature like therapeutic index. The list you can go through on the screen. The best example is when you open your Boric Metra Medica, textbook of homeopathic Metra Medica, we have a therapeutic index where so many remedies are stated against disease diagnosis. Whereas in axiom, we'll say, treat the patient but not the disease. On the contrary, we'll ask the diagnosis and we ask you to code the remedies directly for the nosological diagnosis, right? And once you complete your course and you are a fresher and enter into your practice, we have different thoughts, and we start jumping from one seminar to another seminar. So we have different types of prescriptions, approaches, which confuses a new classical Heinemannian prescriptions, which we have thoroughly trained in our institutions. Constitutional prescription, another point of view. Miasmatic prescriptions, another confusing thought. In final year, when you go, miasms. Third year, we'll read chronic diseases, the theory of chronic diseases by Master Heinemann. You master it. We faced a separate paper on that. And we say miasms are the cause of the diseases. Then there is a confusion for all the students. Then whether the selected remedy has to be constitutional or miasmatic or based on totality, or is it a psychoanalytical approach like Catherine Coulter? Another group of people are emerging now, which is a special case nowadays. Medical protocols, protocol methods are there. And another group of people are writing the seminars, conducting the seminars on pathological specifics. And there is another school, Kentian School, who want to stick on homeopathy and who want to keep homeopathy as a spiritual school alone. And we have keynote prescriptions, favorites. And finally, everyone's favorite, ultimately, the clinical tips. A lot of confusion, right? So most of my students, when they complete their course and they'll go out, they'll raise this question. What is this all about? What we have to follow? Whether clinical tips are classical, whether clinical tips are allowed in our practice or not. Hopefully every student might have had this doubt in their minds while coming out. Of course, practice teaches you a lot of things. Now today's topic, I would like to share my views. I'm not giving any dictum over here. I would like to share my views on all these prescriptions, diversified prescriptions, whether they are relevant today practice or not. Before going to any presentation, let us have a candid introspection. What are we doing? Are we doing right or wrong? See, when you see this picture and ask any first year student to final year student, you can easily say, name some remedies. Invariably, everyone will answer Muxol and Borax. Other remedies will add, of course. When you ask, name some remedies for the fracture, you will say Symphytum, Ruta, Calcareous Floor. Some remedies sprout up, right? Summer bathing, antimicrude. Breast-related disorders based on the problem for weaning, good weaning, or any galactoria problems, you will have a group of remedies. Fine cut or surgical cut or knife cut, staphylococcus aureus, specifically you are telling. Cons, directly you will say antimicrude, hypericum, ranunculus bulbosus, so on and so forth. Sty, we'll say staphylococcus aureus, conium, tuja, list goes on. Nasal polyp or hypertrophy, lamina minor, sanguinaria nitricum, allium sepa, calcareca. No case taking, no totality, no causation, just directly we are mentioning the names of the remedies. Now what is this? Protocol, clinical tips, pathological prescriptions. Are they really relevant? Can we practice them in our practice? So we'll try to cover up these points today. I try to collect some material on what is a protocol. I call it as a clinical tip. A protocol is a detailed plan of scientific or medical experiment. It's a plan, it's a procedure. It's a treatment procedure. To make it simple, it's a plan of treatment which you are designing once you see a case. It's a protocol. So here the protocol is designed based on the nosological name of the disease rather than the classical constitutional what we have been trained in our colleges or medical schools. But everyone cannot create the protocol. Protocols requires a generation of practice or years of thorough practice before you release or you depend on any protocol. Example today, very famous, I can quote Dr. Banerjee's protocol. Experience like Dr. Divan Harishchand and Dr. P. Shankaran, yeah, the famous Dr. Rajan Shankaran's father. You people might have read his contributions. Now, available, based on the available data in the market, the types of protocols, I have tried to classify them under two headings. Protocols can be divided as a simple protocol and complex protocol. What is a simple protocol? When any protocol contains only one remedy. Like I said, example, you want to prescribe one single remedy for mouth ulcer, you quote Mugsol. Because your years of experience has taught you that in such cases, you cannot stop. You can prescribe only Mugsol and that will give you results. And complex protocol is nothing but when more than 2 to 3 remedies are given to a clinical condition, we call it as a complex protocol. Now, examples of simple protocol, Baptisia tinctoria. For typhoid, you might have studied it in Borix, Mater Medica, Banerjee protocols. A list of a big book is contributed by Banerjee, Dr. Pareshnath Banerjee and his group. So better, you can stick on to those things if you have any confusions. Belladonna 6E is most of the people is prescribed for fever. Variolium is a remedy which is given as a protocol by for viral infections. The reference I have given down. Another important contribution by Dr. Boningasan, Silesia and Thuja for the ill effects of vaccination or vaccination, vaccinia. Conium in prostate problems and carcinosinum for mononucleosis, a list I have collected. Now protocols, I can say in my own practice, I can share some protocols that I have been practicing for years. The list of remedies that you see on the screen, Antimtart, Ipecac, Cacus cacti, Aconitum napellus, Spongia tosta, Delcamera, Arsenicum album, Sambucus nigra, Carbovich. A list of protocols I can give you for managing acute asthma for my 20 years or 22 years of my own practice. These are the remedies. I never go out of this list of remedies where acute asthmatic case has been handled very effectively. And along with that, of course, I'll follow with antisoric or constitutional remedy. I have a case presentation testimony. Hopefully my internet connection is very bad today. I have a video. Anyway, I'll switch over. As far as I'm telling here, acute asthma, these are the remedies I've been prescribing as a protocol. So I just wanted to share that throughout my year, never these remedies have downed me. They have been very effective in handling acute diseases. Simple protocols have been given by pioneers. You can take a screenshot if you want. For lack of time, I may not read upon all those things. These are the simple protocols in your Mater Medica you might have already collected. And in the introduction also, I have given some photographs, the introspection I have given. So no need of any case taking in these cases. Directly you can prescribe a protocol. And one of my favorite subject, I have presented so many papers nationally, internationally on simple protocols or specifics mentioned by Heinemann himself. My followers or those who have been following my presentations, they might have gone through these lists. I don't want to go on this. This collection has been given already in some other presentations. Even Dr. Heinemann, in his own literature, he has shared so many simple protocols. Right from 1796, you can see in the first edition itself, Heinemann was so specifically recommending protocols. Even second, third, and fourth editions of Organon, most of them have been utilizing or using these remedies in your practice or in your cases, in your OPD also. You can get so many clinical tips in Heinemann and literature also. For vertigo, I have been using tobacco very effectively. Even in epileptic cases, I have been using tobacco very beautifully and effectively. I'm just jumping down because this paper has been presented already. I just wanted to quote here. The sixth edition, chronic diseases even is filled with so many protocols or specifics of some remedies for disease conditions quoted by Master himself. Even Materia Medica Pura contains simple protocols. So once you are convinced with simple protocols, we can go for complex protocols. Usage of multiple homeopathic remedies for disease condition. So now the controversy comes here. Law of similia, law of simplex. So you cannot use more than one remedy as per the rules, right? But there is a quote from Heinemann's chronic diseases, theory of chronic diseases itself. Under psychotic miasm, introduction and treatment of psychotic miasm, Master Heinemann himself recommends Thuja and nitric acid can be given alternatively. Of course, one after another, one remedy at a time. But the complex protocol method has incorporated one or two remedies, multiple remedies. Another present scenario is the market is filled with homeopathic patent remedies and combination remedies prescribed by even leading homeopathic doctors. So these can be kept under complex protocols. What are the plus points and minus points of protocol methods here? The protocol methods have their pros and cons. The positive points are you can standardize the way of treating homeopathy. What is the standardization? After completing homeopathy, we'll come across and we'll say, if you give one case to two homeopathic doctors, two of them will come out with two different remedies. So standardization was not possible in homeopathy till the protocol method came. So protocol method has its own pros. We can standardize the way of treating diseases. And today's world requires proof. Clinical trials and research methods are possible only with protocol methods. It's very easy to convince the modern medicine that these are the protocols which are applicable on these are the diseases, and anyone can try it because science needs proved, reproved, clinically verified. Any person has to apply them and we have to convince them. And convincing them or convincing the science and convincing the modern research methodologies with a specific research work, we can convince them with protocol methods. And if you are a busy practitioner, it is easy on your brains. The classical homeopathic prescription, no doubt, it limits down your cases per day. And if you are a protocol method doctor, you can see more than 100 cases per day or even 1,000 cases per day. It depends upon you. Helps in increasing the number of your OP patients, saves the time in handling common ailments. Day-to-day practice or general practice becomes very easy to you. What are the problems here? What are the cons of protocol? It contradicts our basic principles. Yes, we agree. We are not individualizing them. Constitutional approach is not applied. Miasmatic approach is not applied. We have to agree that. Patient-physician relationship is at stake. See, so far, most of the patients, they like homeopathic doctor because we do spend time with them. We give more importance to their emotional picture. which is lacking in protocol method. And protocol creates favorite and specific remedies, which is against Heinemannian approach. And when protocol method is in demand, it leads to patent, and patented drugs in a long term can increase the cost of the treatment economically. Next method, classical method, which you are very much aware of. What is the special here? It's a classical method. For academic personalities, most of your lecturers are scolding at me now. Then I present diversified prescriptions here. I'm not supporting any method. In Heinemann's approach, totality of symptoms, mental, physical symptoms, modalities, particular, whatever you have been trained in organon classes, it has been followed beautifully. Of course, Heinemann approach is the ultimate one. Here, the constitutional picture method of study, and your Metramedica, classical Metramedica study and knowledge is going to help you. A simple example for the newcomers I am giving you. This was a case handled by me. It's an old case, but it was a classical case when I was in the initial stages of my practice. I was doing this. It was a case of ovarian cyst. The size was 5.2 into 3.9 centimeters, a little larger ovarian cyst. The case was taken, it was an old case, I told you. The case was taken in June 10th, 2008. The case is very interesting. The lady by name Manjula, she was 23 years at the time, newly married. It was a love marriage. No doubt husband was very good. He was very supportive. The problem is the lady was hailing from a rich family, cultured family, and the boy was a poor fellow, but their family is going on very nicely. But the emotional side of the picture is, the girl used to get up in the middle of the night thinking of their parents, and she used to sob, she used to cry, and she used to suppress her feelings, which the boy noticed. And he told me about this. Of course, anyone can prescribe that. Either it could be Ignatia or Natramune, right? So Natramune was given because it's a prolonged grief. Of course, I have chosen 0/1. I have a water dose methods in 10 spoons of water, and 1 spoon she consumes early morning by empty stomach. Daily she has to repeat it. And you can see that the result, within 2 months, the case has become very beautifully reduced. And even now the entire family is my patient. For every homeopathic treatment, for every problem, they'll come for homeopathic treatment. So Heinemann's approach is the classical methods, very favorite. We have a pros and cons of this approach. It's a very reliable method. You don't have any controversies. And in my opinion, for every autoimmune disorder and for every constitutional problem, systemic problem, it is better to go for a Heinemannian clinical classical approach. It is a real answer. It is the true Heinemannian approach and true homeopathic principle. But the problem is, it is applicable only when you have a qualitative totality. So some 10 days back, I have presented a paper, a tryst with indolence. Some patients will come, they will not give you any symptomatic picture at all. They are very indolent. In such cases, you cannot go for a classical approach because paucity of symptoms are there. And it requires a lot of demand on the physician side. We have to take the case properly. We have to analyze the symptoms. We have to evaluate the symptoms. You have to repertorize. Then you have to consult Organon, Metramedica. We have to industriously and patiently, you have to judge the susceptibility of the patient. Based on the susceptibility, we have to select the potency, and you have to repeat the potency very beautifully, and the doses has to be followed very nicely. And it may be a time consuming process. And as I said in the triad, Organon, Metramedica, and repertory has to be mastered to master this method. Now another method is prescription based on causation. I'll say this is one of the Heinemann's favorite. There will be a question in your 2 marks question, which is the superior method of prescribing remedies or selecting the remedy. Either it is totality of symptoms or causative prescription. Heinemann says causative prescription is the best answer. If you can find out the cause, you can control the effect. Siddhartha effectus, Siddhartha causa. We have studied in Organon. Now, given this picture, whenever this I have been teaching in my classrooms also, whenever I teach Siddhartha effectus and Siddhartha causa, when you show this to any boy, a small boy of 5 years old, and you show this video and you ask him why the building is falling down, he'll say the aeroplane is crashing on the building. So aeroplane is the cause for this crashing of the building. Yeah, it is visible. It is very much visible. So you cannot deny that. It is a recent cause. But when you ask any elderly person, okay, and ask him what is the cause of this falling of the building, obviously he say it is a terrorist attack. There is a terrorist behind this. So the cause here has changed. So remote cause is different, which has led to the recent cause. So the disease has resulted. So a classical prescription also should include the causation. You will do it in analysis of symptoms once you have taken the case. I'll just present. It's a very simple case. I just wanted to present. This is a Marwadi lady. Came to me some 1 month back, and she said she is getting repeated boils all over her body, and every time she visits a doctor, he drains the abscess and removes the pus, and he gives some antibiotics and she goes off. You know, staphylococcal infection or streptococcal infection is the result for disease, and you know, you are a final year student. Initially, by giving your acute prescriptions, here you can apply your protocol methods. Our aim is to only to break the abscess or remove the pus or absorb the pus. So once your protocol method helps here, you'll have to find out the basic cause why this lady is having repeated abscess. Your classical investigations, your knowledge of medicine will help you what may be the reason behind. Example, maybe elevated ASO titer or maybe a history of staphylococcal infection or beta hemolytic staphylococcal infection in the past or any other bacterial infection. We'll have to find out any other systemic reasons. We are not denying that. Once you do that, so removing the presenting complaint or pus is the recent cause, and finding out the main causation for recurrences is the remote cause. So classical prescription can be incorporated, in my opinion, with your protocol methods. Now, what are the pros and cons of this prescription? As I've discussed, the causative versus totality, our aim has to be for prescribing the causation, but not the totality. It can be explained both scientifically and philosophically. Siddhartha effectus, Siddhartha causa used to be a philosophical axiom. Now in science also we are applying it, and it's easy to apply, and unprejudiced and investigative, inquisitive mind of physician has to be there. And of course, artistic application of your general medicine and Mater Medica and Organon has to go hand in hand. A synergetic approach has to be there. Already I quoted, it is one of the Heinemann's favorite. And Heinemann never asked you to confuse between acute and chronic cases. 83 to 104 aphorisms will tell you. In 82 aphorism, Heinemann says, in acute cases, handle only the acute totality. Don't confuse the chronic totality. Because example he gives is, Naxomica patient during acute attack may not be irritable because he's suffering now. But once the acute is over, the chronic mentality of Naxomica returns back. So don't confuse between acute and chronic cases. Prescription based on suppression. I don't want to go into the theory. You have studied the theory. Suppression is very special to homeopathy. Other systems of medicine may not accept it. Even I think as far as Ayurveda Siddha is concerned, they don't have a theory of suppression. They have a theory of palliation. Just for recapping, Heinemann in some cases allows you to palliate. In the first year portion, approach number 87 footnote, and 67 footnote, Heinemann says palliation is allowed in certain cases where life-threatening conditions are there. But suppression is not at all allowed. So how do you prescribe? So you need a knowledge of Mater Medica here, which supplies a good idea of your prescription. I'll share a classical case which I did in my our college OPD. A boy of 5 years was brought to my clinic, and he said he has been suffering with breathlessness, which was diagnosed by probable asthma by allopathic doctor, and he administered some inhalers, bronchodilators to the baby. And the investigation revealed that the baby had no family history of any bronchial asthma or autoimmune disorders. He was hale and healthy, very active prior to this 5 months back. So the past history has revealed that he suffered with severe diarrhea, and he was forced to admit in hospital, which has been immediately controlled by allopathic medications, which we can consider as a suppression. And after this diarrhea suppression, within 10 or 15 days, he started developing breathlessness, which was treated by allopathy doctors, of course, as a different phenomenon. And he was kept under bronchodilators. Now the logic here is the suppression started after the diarrhea. So now once you prescribe, according to your Kenstoll observations, you have to follow your Organon methods. So if you follow this, the baby can get cured. Now here the prescription I gave was sulfur was given and heparsulfur was alternated. Of course, along with my favorite mother tincture for bronchial asthma, Aspidosperma, was kept as a organopathic remedy or a scavenger remedy, we call it as, continuously, daily the baby has taken. And treatment was given for 1 month to 2 months, and it's almost 1 year, 2 years now, the baby is free. And this was also another suppression case. The lady had a uterine hemorrhage, bleeding, heavily she was bleeding, and which was controlled or suppressed by the allopathic doctor. And later she developed eczematous eruptions all over the body. And she was under treatment for 3 to 4 years under a skin specialist. And the history has revealed the uterine bleeding was suppressed forcefully. Later she developed this. I prescribed first initially graphitis, constitutional remedy. I didn't prescribe for suppression here because almost 4 years over and graphitis has cured the case, very straightforward case. As I said, suppression, you cannot show scientific evidence here. There is no laboratory investigation to show that prescription based on suppression is a reliable prescription. Only our Mater Medica and Organon subject will support us. We cannot scientifically prove that. But Heinemann considered it as a superiority. Prescription based on miasms, a great, good subject. I don't want to put more work on this because it's a very deep subject. You know, prescription based on miasm, some people are prescribing only on the miasms. But to quote the pioneers, Dr. Richard Hughes openly criticizes the chronic diseases theory. He may not be fond of. Okay, he is happy with the law of similia, law of simplex, and prescribing the potentized prescriptions. And this was a miasmatic case based on SORA. Sulfur and heparsulfur, two are Heinemann's favorite remedies. I prescribe this. And I don't want to bore you by presenting all the cases because the subject is only to identify the relevance of prescriptions. And this man was already having diabetes, which was under control with allopathy. And no other complaints he has. Because of the old age, the diabetes has developed. Otherwise, he has a very good life, very calm, cooperative personality, very apprehensive. So based on this picture, I have chosen Sura as a miasm. Based on the Sura, I have prescribed this. And theoretically supporting my prescription, Heinemann calls what vitiligo. As a combination of Sura and syphilis. So Sura will be the mother of all miasms. Prescription based on nosodes. Yeah, it's a very big chapter, good chapter. Most of us, we know nosodes as intercurrent remedies, unlocking the cases. Yes, it unlocks, but you know the history. Heinemann wanted to prescribe nosodes not only as a intercurrent remedies or miasmatic blockage remedies, removing them, but they can be used as a acute prescriptions also, provided the picture suits you. Yeah, another important remedy nowadays, very controversial. I have one professor in our college who used to scold us whoever prescribes mother tinctures. He says mother tinctures are not homeopathic prescriptions. But I don't feel so, because masters like Benedict Castro, Dr. Burnett, they have incorporated or they have supported organopathic remedies. If you go to posology chapter, Dr. Stuart Close, genius of homeopathy, posology chapter, Stuart Close says any potency, including mother tincture, can be used as a remedy to cure the condition, but depends upon the susceptibility of the patient. But classically speaking, only potentized remedy has to be prescribed. Above 30 potency was the Heinemann's prescription, 30 potency and above. But Dr. Burnett has mastered this method. And as I said, these are the scavenger remedies. They help in cleansing the systems or cleansing the particular organ which is affected. In the initial presentation of this PPT, I reminded you about different types of prescriptions available. Sometimes in some cases, you may not have to cure. All you have to do is improve the quality of life. These are the commonest organopathic remedies we prescribe. You know them. Yeah, I just wanted to present in which conditions we can go for a prescription based on organopathic remedies. I had 4 to 5 cases of renal agenesis, congenital absence of one kidney. And because of this pressure gradient, vesicoureteric reflex will happen on the opposite kidney. And the liquid or the urine stagnates in the affected kidney or the ureter. And because of this, the patient repeatedly gets hydronephrosis or repeated bacterial infections. The patient is really worried about. The allopathic doctor, either he prescribes antibiotics or he recommends for a removal of the kidney, affected kidney. But in such cases, because it is a congenital anomaly, you may not treat the case when the organ itself is missing. All you have to do is maintain the quality of life. In such cases, all you are left out is only to use the remedies to cleanse the system. So here you are using mother tinctures or organopathic remedies as a scavenger remedies. Such conditions do arise in our day-to-day practice. And another case of tuberculosis where I had to prescribe organopathic remedies. This is also an old case when I was practicing in my college OPD. A drug resistance tuberculosis came to me because we have a TB sanatorium nearby our hospital. And he presented with a drug resistance tuberculosis. So he wanted to switch over to homeopathy. When the case was studied, the patient was affected repeatedly with tuberculosis, and because of this complication, lobectomy was done, and multiple lobes of lungs have been removed, and the remaining lobes are now affected now, and abscess and pus is forming in. So since the lobes are removed, no organ or no vital force can be stimulated. This is perfectly under incurable condition, pathologically advanced condition, where classical prescription. In such cases also, we can rely on organopathic prescriptions. Some list of organopathic remedies. You can take screenshots, or you have a material in your books readily available. Now the list goes on. Such type of so many diversified prescriptions we have in our day-to-day practice, or we come across presented by so many doctors. The first one is the protocol which is happening prescription nowadays. My verdict as a doctor is, I believe today the scenario is changing. If homeopathy is a science and art, science has to advance. Science is not stagnant. Of course, we should never deviate from our similimum. We should never deviate from our basic law. But instead of sticking to our triad, I add tetrad. That is one more knowledge of general medicine. You cannot prescribe any protocol, or you cannot prescribe any prescription, including Heinemann method. Heinemann method, why I'm telling this? To evaluate the symptoms. Evaluation is grading the symptoms according to their hierarchical importance. You have to evaluate the symptoms based on the nosological diagnosis. When you do nosological diagnosis, you have to remove the common symptoms of the disease. Only remaining uncommon peculiar symptoms have to be evaluated. How do you do this removal of common symptoms of disease without the general knowledge or general medicine knowledge? So general medicine is very important even for classical homeopathic prescription. Second point, if you want to create a protocol, you must know what is nosological disease, what is it, what is the prognosis, how do you control it. So this comes only with the knowledge of general medicine. And if you want to create clinical tips also, you need all these knowledge and years of experience, because you need to create a protocol, prove it, reprove it, and clinically verify it. Until unless you do that, your protocol cannot be called as a reliable protocol. Now again, we'll do the introspection applying the triad. You cannot differentiate whether this eruption is because of apathy, B complex deficiency, or oral candidiasis, or cancer of the tongue or mouth, until unless you have a knowledge of organon, mater medica, repertory, and general medicine. Same thing, until unless you have a knowledge, we cannot find out whether it is a physiological fracture or a pathological fracture. Same thing applies to all the other points. See, the plus point with protocol method is it cuts down the time, and it helps you in controlling the initial advanced problematic presenting complaints of a patient initially, and it gives you time to prescribe your constitutional medicine. Yeah, this is my verdict. Whatever mode you choose, all roads leads to Rome. Your aim is to cure the patient by any means, whichever means is good for you. So first approach stands always high. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Ragendra Babu.
Thank you, sir. Please carry on.
Yeah, the chat box has some questions. So,
yeah, can you please help me with?
How to cure chronic drug dependence in chronic cases? Chronic drug dependence. Question from Dr. Satya.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Satya, for the question. I'll quote with quotations, which is my style. Aphorism number 97 to 99. Heinemann says, when a patient comes to you, even Dr. A.K. Das book is also there on Organon, textbook of Organon. We have 2 to 3 volumes are there. When any case comes to you, we have to decide whether the patient is coming from allopathy prescription or homeopathic prescription. Then your plan of treatment changes. Example, a case of epilepsy or case of bronchial asthma, to make it very simple to even a simple student. When a case of epilepsy comes to you, the patient is taking Gardinal or any anti-epileptic medicine for around 10 years. He's dependent now. Now, in such cases, if you stop altogether practically the Gardinal or anti-epileptic and you put a single remedy to that patient, classically speaking, your prescribed remedy has to act on vital force. It has to produce primary action. And as a response, your body has to produce this, vital force has to produce secondary curative action. In between, the patient may have a status epilepticus. So this will become a problem. So Heinemann himself has recommended, if the patient is habituated to a prolonged allopathic or other systems of medicine, best thing is taper it gradually. Of course, the decision has to be taken by the physician, but these are the guidelines based on the condition of the patient. If the disease is fatal, please gradually, abruptly, gradually you have to taper it, not abruptly. Because the attack may be fatal also. Now, when you do this, you cannot choose the classical homeopathic remedy or single remedy, because the anti-epileptic remedy is controlling the presenting complaints of the patient and general symptoms are also suppressed. So even if you consider the totality also, you're not having the true totality. So best thing is introduce some nosodes or any organopathic remedies and gradually withdraw the remedies with your homeopathic medicines, and slowly you progress to your constitutional medicine. This is my approach.
One more question. Reaction. Is there any drug reaction if the mother tinctures are given?
Anything is a balance. See, you are a doctor. You have been trained in pharmacy. You have been trained in Organon. You must know when to do, where to do, and how to do. Last webinar, I was presenting posology, descripting posology. It is how to give that makes you a master. It is the example knife, how the surgeon creatively uses the knife to save the life. So you must know where to stop and when to stop. And that comes only by your Mater Medica and Organon knowledge.
Thank you. One more question. Can remedy be given if it's only covering the causation and not the totality of symptoms?
Yes. Causative prescription. Yeah. Because is there anything? Any question is remaining in that?
No. That is the question.
Fine. See, the Sizeta affecta, Sizeta causa tells you everything. No, the natural law, it is not just medicine and disease. Nothing in this world happens without any proper cause. So if you want to control the effects, you have to control the causation. So causation, once you control it, the effects will automatically stop. So that is why prescribing for the causation is a very good prescription. Example, in Mater Medica, we have getting wet in rain, Rustox, summer bathing, Antim crude, heavy food intake, Pulsatilla. Even Heinemann himself has recommended. I quoted it. I didn't present it thoroughly because it was a separate topic. So many times I presented specifics given by Heinemann himself. Though they named it as specifics, they are actually attacking the causation. in acute totality. So causation is the superior one, sir.
See, now one more question relevant to the modern day, they've asked is this immunomodulator.
Yeah.
Variolinum or arsenic alva for the COVID-19.
you are keeping me under trouble.
No, question has come some now I'll ask.
I'll answer it. No problem. I'll answer it. It's a controversial subject. As a homeopath, I am ready to handle COVID also, because I have my own support, Stuart Close, the pathology and homeopathy chapter. The first two paragraphs, Stuart Close says, homeopathy is a very good system even in controlling virus, bacterial and fungal infections. No doubt we can, because we are keeping the viral infections under acute mask. See, this COVID outbreak we are talking about is also an acute exacerbation. We don't consider it as a chronic causation here. So virus is an acute miasm. It's a recurrent acute miasm we are keeping under, so we can easily handle it. Now the question is whether variolum has to be given or arsenic alva has to be given. Technically speaking, arsenic has to be given to be on the safer side, because we have been guided by CC. CCH.
Yeah.
Yeah. But arsenic alba has been supported by so many doctors. If you want a thorough opinion on this, my opinion on this, you go to Dr. Nagendra's Homeo Clinic YouTube channel. I have elaborately given in the month of March itself how to handle COVID cases, because my students have demanded it. The video is still available.
That's nice of you. Now one more.
I think I have escaped.
Not escaped, but it is, the curiosity is now mounting, because the COVID is becoming more and more, aggressive now. People are getting more and more affected. The community is getting affected. So, the curiosity is there always. What homeopathy can do.
Sir, if you want to add, I can boost up the students with my whatever I have learned from my practice. See, generally what happens is in microbiology, we'll say every bacterial infection has a rise, plateau and decline. The same thing applies to viral infection also. When any virus, however pathogenic it is, when it is prevalent in our society, when it remains as a human being, as a living creature, we will develop herd immunity. That is what happens. Once we develop herd immunity, automatically we are protected from virus, whatever virus it may be.
Yeah.
In my personal opinion, COVID has been hyped by the media unnecessarily. And homeopaths are capable. According to WHO, the clinical manifestation of COVID is divided into four stages. First two stages are very meager or mild cases. Homeopathic doctors can easily handle them. Once it goes above the level, third stage and fourth stage, where the fibrosis of the lungs or disseminated infection happens in the system, better it is not handled by homeopathic doctors, and please refer them. Anyway, legally, I am not recommending it, because government will take the action.
Yeah. Correct. That should be a bone in the mind. Now, since you are into the protocols, right, the studies, there's one question.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
What
yes, sir.
Is the usual yeah. success rate of protocol study, protocol method versus the classical method?
Sir, as I said, protocol methods, I am not superior in that. Dr. Banerjee has mastered in it. And I respect him for one thing.
Mm-hmm.
See, most of the doctors, when I was a student and when I came out, most of the doctors were not openly coming out with their methods. And Banerjee doctor was dare enough to publish a book. And he presented daringly in olden days, not in homeopathic seminars, he presented in international allopathic seminars successfully. And his protocol methods, he proves, he claims. I'm not telling his methods are very applicable to everyone, but he claims, openly he claims. But protocol methods, as I said, they cannot replace the classical methods. As I said, for autoimmune disorders, even today, I educate the patient and I apply classical single remedy. But I limit protocols to acute cases. This is my practice.
So that means the protocols for diabetes and hypertension may not be more effective. Classical is more. Because there is one question on this.
Yes.
Protocol for diabetes and hypertension.
Yeah, diabetes and hypertension is not a disease. It's a disorder, right? As far as academics are also concerned, it is a disorder. And disorder has to be brought into order by, in my opinion, by diet, regime, exercise, and all these things will control the metabolism. So metabolic changes and symptomatic management. That is what we have to do in diabetes, in my opinion. That is how I handled. I have been handling so many cases of diabetes. It's almost 23 years completed in my clinical practice. And successfully, I managed to keep my patients away from allopathic antibiotics. Of course, some cases will move out of my hands, which I have to recommend to allopaths out of force.
There are two, three questions which appeared for in relationship to intercurrent remedies. Like
yes, sir,
intercurrent related to Hanumanian concept, and also in your practice, what is the application of intercurrent remedies in practice?
I usually do that. To be frank, I am teaching Organon. So I feel that gave me a good introduction to intercurrent remedy. But I learned the application of intercurrent remedy from Dr. Kopikar. He is a Bhishmacharya, I call it as, from South India. Yeah. He is the first BHMS qualified doctor in Tamil Nadu and Madras. And he is no more now. I call as a Ekalavya Sishya to him.
Yeah.
I learned from his literature. Mm-hmm. And he gave me two remedies. I'll tell you, Drozira and Beretacap. And he said, Drozira and Beretacap can be used as a intercurrent remedies in any recurrent respiratory infections of any children. And after reading that, I applied it in my practice. And to my astonishment, it works very beautifully. I'm openly telling you, you go to Dr. Kopikar's book, read that, Drozira and Beretacap are quoted, and you give as an intercurrent remedy Drozira. And how Dr. Kopikar recommends is, if you go to drug pictures, ML Taylor's drug picture, ML Taylor says there are two people who know much about Drozira. One is Heinemann, second one is ML Taylor. Because she quotes Curie's experiments. Heinemann limited his Drozira to 30 potency. But when Curie experimented Drozira on cats, Drozira has a capacity to produce tuberculosis. So Drozira is a Pardon me, I have a problem with my internet connection. It's raining here.
Yeah.
Is it audible, sir?
Yes.
Yeah, since Drozira has a capacity to produce tuberculosis, he termed it as a tubercular miasmatic. And most of the recurrent cold infections are tubercular in nature. And based on this logic, I tried to apply. See, I experiment. I openly say, though I am an Organon professor, I openly say everywhere, I experiment to learn. I respect classical method. But when I applied Drozira, you can believe that I have so many allopathy doctor kids taking treatment for bronchial asthma and sinusitis from me, and successfully within 1 or 2 years, however long it may be, we can totally stop the inhaler usages and we can bring back the normal healthy state to the patient. Please try Drozira and Beretacap as an intercurrent remedy, and please use intercurrent remedy. I'll quote two more. Last, this thing also I quoted. I quote from Heinemann. Don't call it as a repetition because Heinemann is the master. Naxomica. Naxomica in high doses, for every bleeding disorder in a female, Heinemann recommends as a specific remedy. It's an intercurrent. Heinemann, you wanted you to use Naxomica as intercurrent in bleeding disorders. And you apply it, it works. It is there in the literature. Why are we going to seminars?
Yeah, correct. So when you spoke about Dr. Kopikar, I had an opportunity to visit his clinic in Chennai when I visited him, and he also visited the Mullers.
Yes, very simple, very learned man.
He quotes from Hahnemann.
Very active. Even at the ripe age, he was very active.
Yes. In that day. You made that our memories come back again about him.
Nostalgia.
Dr. Nagendra, one more question. Sudden onset of stammering in a 3.5-year-old child after a particular incident at home, should we just consider the causation? Or in such a child, are we going to get causation? That is what the question is here from Dr. Sunita Pillai.
Yeah, my analysis or investigation of the case will be the stammering, whether it was there previously or this happened only after this incident. The seventh aphorism, Hahnemann says, Zophile and Erscheinungen, causative events. See this causation, if the baby was not stammering prior to this incident, then you have to consider the causation. If the baby had a episodes of stammering in between, then you have to go for a classical case study, like whether it is a organic or psychological, and you have to proceed. The inquiry and history reveals everything, madam.
Okay. Yes. Good. In fact, questions are there. Some of the questions are, but still now we are going to the end of the session. I would like to conclude. All the people who are on the chat box, I thank you for your sharing of your questions. I'm sure Dr. Nagendra Babu has clarified your doubts and he has given the answers. Today we had a session on diversified prescriptions. Sir has prescribed wonderful simple protocols for practice, complex protocols, and is also verified results through modern research methodology. You had a very good literature reference and also presentation of good number of cases. Now, this is what we have to think something, in a different way. And that is what Dr. Nagendra Babu has presented today. I thank you, Dr. Nagendra Babu.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you all.
Thank the audience. Over to Dr. Shweta Bhatt.
On behalf of the organizing team, Provision 2020, I express my gratitude and respect for our distinguished speaker, Dr. G. Nagendra Babu, for sparing his valuable time for us and enlightening us with his commendable presentation on relevance of diversified prescriptions. Thank you, sir. I would also like to thank the moderator of today's session, Dr. Shiv Prasad K., principal of Fadamalu Homeopathic Medical College. I would like to thank the administrator, Reverend Father Roshan Krasta, Principal Dr. Shiv Prasad K. again, and the Vice Principal Dr. ESJ Prabhukiran for their valuable support for Provision 2020. I express my gratitude to the webinar organizing team headed by Dr. Dheeraj Fernandez, who have been working hard to make this webinar series a successful one. Finally, I thank all the delegates who have dedicated their time in being a part of us and also actively participating in this session. We have the best of sessions coming up in the upcoming days. Stay tuned with us. Dear delegates, tomorrow we are having a session